Hey guys, my name's Shelby Seals. I'm a recording arts bachelor student at Full Sail University. This is my producer podcast, and the producer I decided to go with was Jerry Finn, mainly because he produced my favorite band, Blink-182, alongside, you know, many other artists in the pop, punk, and rock genre, such as Green Day, AFI, Alkaline Trio, Sum 41, and many more. He first became an assistant at the Music Grinder in Hollywood, where he was later hired as a second engineer. He met Rob Cavallo when he moved to Devonshire Sound Studios, and this is actually where he became Rob's right-hand man while producing Green Day's Dookie in 1994. Afterwards, Jerry worked as an assistant at Conway Recording Studios, which he actually claimed as his favorite studio to work in. However, several months later, he left to work independently because of the success of Dookie. He began a successful partnership with Epitaph Records, where he co-produced About Time by Pennywise. And in the late 90s is when he formed a strong bond with Blink-182. He first worked with them recording Mutt for the American Pie soundtrack. He then produced their breakthrough album, Enema of the State, where they chose never to work with another producer again. According to Mark Hoppus, which is the bassist of Blink-182, when recording sessions became contentious, Jerry would often smooth over differences with humor, advice, and a new perspective. And that's about the time she walked away from me. Nobody likes you when you're 23. Let's take a laugh with them and, you know, have fun during their sessions. Jerry later returned to produce The Mark, Tom, and Travis Show in 2000, Take Off Your Pants and Jacket in 2001, and then their self-titled album in 2003. He also produced Boxcar Racer's self-titled debut album in 2002, and then he co-produced and mixed When Your Heart Stops Beating by Plus 44 in 2006. Jerry was known for his dynamic, warm guitar sound, much like on Blink-182 albums and Sum 41's All Killer No Filler. He achieved this sound by recording through more than one amplifier at a time. He liked to use large diaphragm condenser mics and a ribbon mic to record electric guitars. He would place these next to the grill, one just left to center while the other's just right to center, and then he would mix these two sounds together and add effects then. He would often focus on room mics to capture the nature or the natural ambience of the drums. You know, Travis said he'd sit around drinking coffee and smoking cigarettes just praying he'd be able to start playing soon, because Jerry would actually spend hours just adjusting mics to get the sound he's looking for. As for his producing style, he was more about giving ideas and lending an extra set of ears. Jerry could push musicians and singers to perform at their best. One thing I do like about Jerry is the fact that he'll sit there and hang out with his clients. He'll order food and just talk to them, get to know them. You know, it creates a relaxed environment to work in. He would occasionally mix albums for independent bands or friends, anywhere from free to half of his normal rate, just because he enjoyed the music. Now in his later years, he worked with Morrissey on his best-selling You Are the Quarry in 2004 and Years of Refusal in 2009. This, unfortunately, was his last completed production before his death at 39. Now, Finn was known for his cheerful and optimistic attitude as well as his professional expertise. Now, after his death, Alternative Press compiled a list of 9 classic albums produced by Jerry and wrote that Finn's bread and butter during the past decade was helping rough punk bands refine their sound and helping them discover the power of a good vocal hook. I can definitely respect what Jerry has done for Blink-182, his style of mixing and just recording. He had over 100 guitars and, you know, amplifiers he would bring into the studio just to get the sound he was looking for.